Radhika, can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
You are live. I'm going to get off. You are live.
Oh, okay. So
Radhika,
I.
Can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
You are live. I'm going to get off. You are live.
Yeah. Oh, okay. I hope there's no echo.
So
Radhika,
I.
Can you hear me?
Yes,
I can.
You are live. I'm going to get off. You are live.
Yeah. Oh, okay. I hope there's no echo.
So Radhika,
can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
You're alive. I'm gonna get off. You're alive.
Oh, okay. I hope there's no echo.
Can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
You're alive. I'm gonna get off. You're alive.
Oh, okay. I hope there's no echo.
Can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
You're alive. I'm gonna get off. You're alive.
Oh, okay. I hope there's no echo.
Can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
You're alive. I'm gonna get off. You're alive. Radhika, you're logged on twice. You have to close one of your windows. You're logged on twice. That's why we're hearing an echo. You have to close one of these windows and then share your screen from one window. Does that make sense?
Can I start?
Yeah, but you have to close one of these screens. That's why we're getting echo. You're logged in. Okay, I see your screen. Yeah, you can start now. I'm going to log off.
So I'm going to start. I don't see my participants, but I'm going to start now. Is that all right? Raymond, I hope I'm audible. Okay. Can I start? Okay. Can I start? I hope. Okay, great. Okay. So thank you. I'm enjoying being in Wikimania. This is my first time. Let me introduce myself. I'm Radhika Mamidi. I'm part of this team that we call ourselves, we all work at IIIT Hyderabad, that's in India. And we are working towards developing articles in Telugu Wikipedia. So this is my team, and they also have a session on Monday. So basically, we are trying to increase, I mean, our intention is to increase the number of articles in Telugu Wikipedia, which has very small number. If we look at this, for example, let me make it larger. So if you look compared to other languages, the number of articles in Telugu, my language, my mother tongue, basically, so it's like 70,000 articles at the moment. Now, our team intention is to increase this number using different methods. So some methods are by building community and writing from scratch, manual translation of existing textual materials using machine translation system, and then, of course, using technology. And the most important thing is that we have to invest our energies in quality checking by human post editors. Now, that is our motivation, that to increase the content in Indian Wikipedia. So basically, we are not working on all the languages at the moment, on Telugu and Hindi later. So this is my title, which says to translate or not to translate by the machine. That's the question. Okay, thank you to many thanks to Shakespeare for this dilemma. But I hope by the end of the session, our dilemma will be solved. So this is how I have planned to go with my outline. So we look at translation, then machine translation, some of the problems that exist when we take English as the source language and try to translate into Telugu. And then some of the, given the time constraint, let me also see some of the post-editing challenges that one would face. Coming to translation, translation is needed to break the language barrier. So today's world, where with the help of internet and web 3.0, all that, you know, the barriers is no longer there. But at the same time, interest in one's own language has become important. Like even in India, like most of us are bilinguals, we know English, but at the same time, we want to do something for our own languages. So most of the knowledge is available in English, but we want the same to be available even in our mother tongue. So human translators' advantage is that the translation quality is of very good, good nature. It's of publishable quality. But in spite of all that success in machine translation, we can still say that human translators are unchallenged. Now, but if we actually say that human translation is that good, you know, machines are useless, then let us look at some examples. So we have seen, multiple translation where humans have done lots of errors, and human translators take more time to translate compared to machines. Similarly, human memory has its limitations. For example, you may spend lots of time looking up for an equivalent in your language, but after 10 days, you may have forgotten that word. You have to look up again. Okay. So this memory is one of the things that machines have. That's an advantage a machine would have over us. Now, this is just to show that, you know, we have to be kind to machines because humans are also not so good in translation. So many of us would come across some funny translations, right? So example, this is at a hotel lobby that says that the lift is being fixed for the next day. During that time, we regret that you'll be unbearable. Now, this is in a country where English is a second language. You can see that, you know, the word could have been please tolerate or something, you know, but when it's translated using the native nuances, it may become something humorous. So there are some more examples here to show that translation by humans also can be funny. So this is one from India, which says eating carpet is strictly prohibited. So you can, as linguist, I can make out, you know, it's the last of a preposition here that is making it funny. But this is the most dangerous translation. It says hand grenade. So given this, let us look at what is translation. So translation is an art, or translation is a science, translation is a craft. So there are different people, philosophers, linguists, psychologists, sociologists, they have also contributed to the theory of translation. So many argue that translation is an art because a translator actually uses imagination, actually uses creativity to come up with another text. But at the same time, scholars like Eber say that it is a craft because it needs lots of practice, lots of training to do a good job at translation. But we can say that compared to human translation, then machine is a craft. Machine translation is a craft. You need lots of skills to do that, lots of training to do that, and lots of data, everything to learn from. So this is a picture I took. This is from some money-related site, but so this is a good ecosystem that shows that both machines and humans can be a part of this whole exercise, translation exercise, which shows that humans as post editors contribute to good translation. So one need not say that machine translation is the final say, but once the output is come, post editors can contribute to it. So let us look briefly about machine translation. Many of you may already know about the history of machine translation, but let us quickly go spend a couple of minutes on that. So we have come a long way from here when the initial machine translation system translated this sentence funnily. Today, of course, it translates much more appropriately. So machine translation follows the same path as human translation. That is, it decodes the meaning of the source text and re-encodes this meaning in the target language. So basically, it analyzes and generates language. Analyzes the source text and generates the same meaning in the target language. So for any translation, whether it's human or machine, so it needs five types of knowledges. So knowledge about the source language, knowledge of target language, the equivalent between source and target language, knowledge of the domain, and general knowledge, world knowledge, and socio-cultural aspects. Like, for example, if you're translating from English to, say, French, you should be aware of all the conventions of French culture. So basically, the linguistics of source language and the linguistics of target language are essential for a good translation system. The same applies to machine translation system. But today, everybody, many people try to criticize machine translation, but one of the reasons is that the fault, I won't say fault, but the human language itself is complex, it's filled with ambiguities. So trying to develop algorithms based on such kind of data becomes difficult even for a machine to translate, especially with languages that are not similar. So a little bit of history. It all started after World War II when 60 Russian sentences were translated into English and with very good accuracy. And money went into that research, but after 10 years, it was a setback because the expectations were not met. And in later, in 1980s, with increase in mathematical and statistical models, once again, interest in machine translation came around. And by 1990s, there were many translating systems, but they all were translating single sentences. Later, they started translating at document level as well. At the same time, in parallel, the human translations were assisted by machines in the form of translation memory, in the form of machine-readable dictionaries. So this was happening parallel. So human translation was assisted by machine. And then we had machine translation systems assisted by humans. So by the turn of century, that's like last 20 years, we can see that the machine was actually producing good quality translation. Now, so today machine translation systems are used for translating large number of documents, say United Nations or European Union, where multilingual culture is there. Similarly, machine translation systems are used to translate highly advanced thing. You know, every day things are changing, and having humans becomes difficult. Like human to translate, say, 300-page book on the latest in medical field, it may take 1 year to translate, but by then things change in the field. So having a machine to translate within 1 hour is much more easier. And then on top of that, the domain expert and language expert can post-edit it. So quickly go over the existing machine translation systems. We have, in chronological order, we had rule-based systems, then example-based machine translation systems, statistical, and today we have most successful ones are based on neural network models. So these are some figures just to show that when the languages are very close, you can just use a dictionary to translate between the languages. As we go a little higher, transfer rules. So you can incorporate rules here to translate between the two languages. Interlingua, when you want to translate into multiple languages, say one source and many multiple languages, having interlingua is the best method. But this was the early method. Then came example-based machine translation, where, for example, I took this from the web. You have this sentence, I'm going to the cinema, but the parallel corpus already had a similar sentence with the 90% of the similar words there. And the machine would learn that, okay? So cinema is kino, okay? Because the structures are very same. So this is like when there is a parallel corpus, it aligns them and then learns the phrases, equivalents of the similar phrases. A little advanced over ABMT statistical machine translation, it learns, it keeps on learning. Okay, so there is a machine learning being done, like this example again, picture I took from the web, which shows that the machine is understanding that ambiguous word, how it gets disambiguated by the human in presence of other words. And this is a neural machine translation model, which has many hidden layers, and this is more closer to the human translation. So I'm just saying that we have different methods, and today NMT and SMT, that's the statistical and the neural ones, are the most successful methods. And like any other application, evaluation of the systems is a must. And the oldest method, of course, is the human judges, but they are very expensive. We also have automated methods. Today we use Blue, NIST, Meteor. So that's about machine translation system. Most of you may have used at least two or three systems even while writing Wikipedia articles. So some of them I have listed here, but there are many more commercial products also. So there are big companies as well as small companies who are into the market. Now, coming to this, why machines don't translate as expected, is that languages themselves have different structures, different morphology, that's word structures. Like Telugu does not have determiners, and finding equivalents of idioms, collocations, metaphors is very difficult, and then there is ambiguity. Now, that said, I will just talk about Telugu language because that was what I wanted to share. So this is Telugu, the greener part, and it's a language spoken in the southern part of India. And this is, it belongs to the Dravidian language, but India has many more language families, including, so this is the Dravidian part. We have Indo-Aryan, Indo-Iranian, we have Austroasiatic, Tibeto-Burman. So normally, I don't know the exact number, but they say there are more than 800 languages in India. So we can say at least 25 to 30 languages are more popular, like education is imparted in those languages. But otherwise, Wikipedia, I think there are around 10 to 15 languages maybe in Indian languages. And Hindi has more number of articles compared to other languages.